So hi guys, Jonathan Graham here for Guitar Interactive Magazine. We are sitting here with the one and only Jared James Nichols. How are you doing, buddy?
Brother, I'm so glad to be
The big man. The big man is in town.
I'm back.
Back, but mate, you're back in London. It's always a pleasure to see you. Now, you've been doing this fantastic tour with the Winery Dogs the last few shows. How has it been out on the road with these guys?
It's been amazing, man. To be quite honest with you, I'm so inspired watching them play because they're so good. I've been a fan of Richie Kotzen for years, all of his solo work, and now we're buddies. Like, night one, dude, we hit it off.
Yeah.
And it's the no-pick tour, because, you know, Richie doesn't play with a pick.
Of course.
Yeah, so it's the no-pick tour.
Of course. Yeah, no, I mean, I would have expected that you would be a fan, obviously, because, you know, there aren't too many of these guys that are about that are that sort of 1-2 punch as in themselves, you know?
Oh, yeah.
You know, they can play the guitar incredible vocals, and that's the same with yourself. So you guys were always going to have hit it off. But what was your first sort of, impressions of Richie? What was the first time you heard him play?
I'm thinking the first time I heard Richie play was actually a little later. So I moved to Los Angeles when I was 21, and he was obviously living in Los Angeles, and the players I was around, they were like, hey, have you heard Richie Kotzen? And I was like, no, name rings a bell. But I was so, at this time, just into blues.
Yeah.
I was into blues and blues rock guys, like, only. So even, like, when it came to, like, guys like Richie that could, you know, were a little more on, I don't want to call him a shredder, but, you know, he shreds.
Sure.
But I really wasn't really into that. And when I heard him play, like, my jaw dropped. He had a record called Into the Black. And when I heard that record, I was like, man, this is so good. Like you said, not only is it his guitar playing, but it's also his songwriting and his voice and his harmonies and the way that he makes tracks. And it was cool to talk to him the other night. And I kind of fanboyed out. I was like, man, I'm such a fan. And he's like, really? And he's like, what have you listened to? And I named off every single one of his records.
Yeah.
And then at the end of that conversation, it was, well, let's write a song together. So.
Oh, wow. Now we know Richie's done some great collaborations in the past. So.
Yeah.
I take it you're going to make sure this happens.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah, I told him. You know, what's funny now is he's obviously traveling so much with the Winery Dogs, but now I travel so much, and I said to him, okay, we got to put something on the calendar so we get together and we do this.
Oh, man.
That would be a dream come
true. That would be fantastic. I cannot wait to hear that. Now, you know, you're obviously out supporting the self-titled record. I want to talk a good bit about that as well, because, you know, I think it is the best that you've done to date.
Thank you, man.
You can understand why you wanted to call it your name, because it almost is, it's like you've truly arrived with this record. It's fantastic.
Thank you.
But you're also, you know, playing some stuff that isn't even on a record, like last night in Nottingham.
Yeah.
You're still testing out new. So, you know, talk us through that. I take it you're still writing new stuff all the time, yeah?
Yeah, so I moved from California to Nashville, Tennessee at the end of 2019. And once kind of the pandemic hit and everything, I really tried to almost hit the reset button. Mm. And I wanted to try and focus on different stuff, songwriting, my vocals, like things more. Because when you're on the road all the time, I feel like you just get caught in this, like, show, travel, sound check, you know, all of these things. And it's hard to focus on, okay, I'm going to write. So I made it a priority to start writing. And to date, besides the new record, I have 112 songs that I've written in the past 2 years.
Wow.
Yeah. So sometimes my brain, I just go for something, and it's cool because they're all demoed out. But when it comes to, like, we're trying out new stuff already, and it's awesome to see the reaction, because I don't know about you, but sometimes when I see a band, if it's a song I don't know or something that I'm like, what is this? It could kind of be like, I'm going to go get a beer. But people are loving it.
Yeah.
So it's exciting. And like you said, with the self-titled record, it feels like I arrived.
Yeah.
We cut that record to tape. We played in the studio all together. No click track. We tuned the guitars to each other. It was so old school, but it was so real.
Yeah, of course. That makes perfect sense. And even before that dropped, you were road testing a lot of those tracks on the tour. So, you know, is that going to be a staple for you, do you think, that it's always going to be like, let's see how the audience actually reacts to it? Because in a lot of ways, you actually feel like the audience becomes part of the whole process for you.
I do. When I write, especially when I'm writing, because sometimes now I write for different artists too, but when I'm writing for me, and I try and almost think about the listener only. And I don't mean that in a way that I'm not thinking about the music, but I'm thinking about how they would experience it. Because I think the biggest piece of playing guitar and of writing songs and performing live is the connection. Mm. A lot of artists and musicians, I feel like they forget about that. And that's okay if that's what they want to do, is almost serve themselves through the music. Mm. But when I write and when I play guitar, I want that person out there to feel what I'm feeling.
Of course.
And I want to try and get that connection. So when I'm writing something, I'm like, I'm imagining myself like tonight, like Shepherd's Bush Empire, like, what's this riff going to sound like? You know, like close your eyes and you're like, what will this sound like through the PA to a crowd? Yeah. And what will this chorus, you know what I mean? Mm. I think about stuff like that now. Even the way I approach guitar now, it's like, when I'm practicing, I practice with an intent of like, what am I going to use what I'm working on for? Okay. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I think that's really important, because a lot of times you can kind of get stuck doing stuff that maybe you're like, I don't know why I'm doing this.
Yeah. And of course you can use something new every day. Yeah. A challenge or how you've woken up or how your voice feels in the morning, and use that as a positive, you know. Mm-hmm. Now you've got this incredible instrument here on your lap, which we've got to talk about. Now we know that it's got one hell of a story. Could you just share it for us?
Absolutely. So I acquired this guitar a little less than 2 years ago. Mm. This guitar is named Dorothy. Now here's the story. It's a great story. Shout out to my buddy TJ Duckweiler, who he knows who he is. I'll get to him, and my friend JW Restoration, and a lot of other players, I'll tell them all. So in 2021, I was at home like everybody else, and I got a message on Instagram. It was a message with a picture and said, tap to view, you know? And I was like, uh-oh. But it said, hey man, I know you like old Les Pauls. Check out this guitar that landed in my yard after a tornado. And I was like, huh? So I clicked the picture, and what I see is a broke, no neck, this body, obviously no strings, that's not there, a knob's missing, and it's full of mud and debris, and it looks like someone pulled it out of a junkyard. And I was like, but you know, like I do, we as guitar players were crazy. So I looked at it and I went, okay, these two screws, the only Les Pauls, if this is stock, it would have been the earliest run had those two screws. Mm. And I could kind of tell from the picture that the knobs were extra tall.
Right.
So in my head, I'm going, you know, there was no holes for a tailpiece or anything. I said, that's an early 52. Mm. No poker chip or, you know,
sure.
No chip.
Yep.
I said, that's an early 52. So I hit him back and I said, hey man, what are you doing with that guitar? This is crazy. Mm. It was in a tornado. And he said, yes, this guitar actually landed in his yard. And he went out and picked it up. And it took maybe, I think he said like over a year to find out whose it was.
Right.
When he did, he found out that the original owner's daughter, she claimed it on her insurance, and she told him, just keep it and hang it on your wall. So he said, I think I want to get it restored. Mm. And I was like, oh man, that's incredible. I said, I have a lot of friends that I could lead you in the right direction. Mm. And he said, I'm thinking about sending it to Gibson. And I said, wow. I said, well, it's a hard one, because a guitar like this, it's not like you're sending back even like a 55 Les Paul or a Burst or anything. Mm. It's got the weird neck angle. Like, this is one of the first ones. So I said to him, yeah, you could do that. And I said, well, what? You know what? Why don't we just hop on a phone call? So we got on the phone, we started talking, and he was like, we started talking about our influences, because he played guitar, he played metal, he still does. And anyways, I said, well, listen, man, I'll point you in the right direction. I said, but if you ever want to sell that guitar, or you'd ever, you know, consider letting it go, I would love the chance to own it and get it replayed and back on the road.
Of course.
He called me the next day. He said, hey man, I'm just gonna give you the guitar. He goes, I didn't buy it, I'm not gonna sell it, and I like the idea of you having it, getting it fixed, and taking it out on tour. And I said, no way. Like, I have to give you something for it. So I gave him one of these. I gave him my one of my JJN Gold Glories.
Absolutely.
But anyway, so the story continues. I go up, drive, he's in Illinois, right? Now this tornado that this guitar was in, it was like, what do they call it? Like on the Richter scale. Like it was one of the worst tornadoes in the history of this town. Mm. Like I think that maybe 14 people have actually died from it. Mm. Tons of homes destroyed, terrible. People lost their stuff, horrible. And this guitar, when I got it, like I went to that town and I was like, wow, this is crazy. He pulled this out of a drawer, and there's no neck, mind you.
Yeah.
And it's the body. And I looked at it and I went, whoa. It was in a lot better shape back then. But if you look at it, you can see there's no doubt about the age. But then when I flip it around, a lot of that you can see right here. Yep. There's chunks actually missing around the edge. This whole scrape, you know, like it hit the asphalt.
Unbelievable.
This is all me already. I've added a lot to it, but here's the crazy part. So we get the guitar, I said, does it still work? And he looks at me, he goes, does it work? And I was like, yeah. So we plug it in, I hit it with a screwdriver, hit the pickup.
Just to test, yeah.
All the electronics are perfect. It's insane. All original, all perfect.
Unbelievable, unbelievable. So and for, you know, that's the thing, to be able to take an instrument like that, put new life through it, and then taking it out on the
yep.
road. I mean, can you just let us hear like a little
absolutely,
bit of just how
man.
Special this is?
Yeah, for sure. So, like I said, this is untouched stuff. So if we, I'm playing through my 2-watt amp, so mind you. It's so touch sensitive, so when I roll that down. And then moving to our neck pickup. It's just smooth. And then the best part about this guitar, I feel like, is when I plugged it in, a lot of 50s, P90s, you know, the neck will outweigh the bridge.
Sure.
But when I plug this thing in, I'm like.
Killer.
Cool, right?
I mean, you know, I'm totally like, blown away by this thing, and the fact that it's coming through that tiny little amp as well.
But, I hope people realize what we're playing
yeah,
through.
Yeah, you know, but, you know, there are some pretty magical fingers here that are making these sounds. But just to talk about that with the neck pickup, because,
yeah.
you know, a lot of the time as well, like on your signature model, you don't
yeah.
bother with the neck pickup.
Totally.
And a lot of the time when you're picking up a Les Paul,
mm-hmm.
you can get quite a muddy sound is the standard sort of
yes.
what you associate with the neck pickup
absolutely.
And a Les Paul. What do you think is so special about that era's neck pickup?
So here's my thought process behind it. Growing up, when I'd play a humbucker Les Paul, bridge, awesome, because I'm using my fingers.
Mm.
When I'd, like you said, flip up to the neck, it sounded too duddy. It was just like, you know, just like dark.
There's no bite.
There's no bite, yeah. there's nothing. Mm. But what I'm noticing, the more I play, when it comes to, first off, P90s. If you haven't tried P90s, you should really give them a shot, because yes, there is a buzz, but it's so worth it when you get it right. So that's one thing. But what I noticed with this era of P90s, now there's a lot of time that I attribute it to how old they are.
Mm.
Maybe, you know, there's the magnet of, I was just at Seymour Duncan, I asked him, is that true? You know, and they said, yeah, there's a lot that a magnet can be demagnetized a little bit over time, right?
Okay.
But I don't know exactly what it is in the mojo. I think a lot of it also, Bonamassa told me too, he said a lot of it has to do with the capacitors as well as the pods. You know, that's a big sound of the kind of the 50s wiring. But what I started to notice with this era 50s P90s, right? It's neck. And I mean, we're on like the super crunch mode, but when I back off, there's a certain smoothness. Almost stratty.
Well, there's like a texture, isn't there?
Yeah, there's a texture.
Killer.
There's something about it where I can even do like, you know, like I'm such a Stevie Ray, I'm such a Stratocaster Guitar Hero fan, so that. It sounds like
it could
to
trick
me.
You. It could
it
trick,
trick you.
You. Yeah.
And I'm right now, my volume is at 3, tone is all the way up. As you roll it up, what I notice is a lot of modern pickups, when you roll up the neck, it's just everything. It's just this kind of just like you throw it all at the kitchen sink. But these still maintain a clarity, and there's also like a mid pump in them. So like if I bring this all the way up, then it starts to sound like, you know, Clapton-y, you know. Lots of overtones.
Wow, that's cream all day, isn't it?
There's just so much to them, and I really mean this when I say this, like, with like a guitar like this, that has such, I say it's like a voice.
Yeah.
It's like whatever I throw at it, it can take it. And don't sleep on the P90 gold tops, the old ones.
You say that about a voice, but what's so important, of course, is you've always got something to say.
That's
with
right.
That voice.
That's right.
What's the key to that for you?
The key to that for me is a few different things. Don't take yourself too seriously as a player or as a person. I think life's too short to do that. I think you got to remember at the end of the day that when we pick up our guitars, it's got to be fun. You got to have fun, because everything else on this planet can be hard to deal with. But when we pick up our guitars, you should have fun. And also, I think you shouldn't be afraid to try different things. Don't be afraid to make mistakes. I make mistakes all the time. Like, honestly, man, like I'll be going for something and it can either be the best thing I've ever played, and you're like, how did he do that? Or it can be like, oh, I don't know about that. So for me, staying fresh is, I try not to like beat myself up anymore. Like, you know, I used to do like exercises where I go like, yeah, all the different,
sure.
Now, finger style guy. Yeah, doing stuff like that. And that's great for dexterity. But sometimes I try and think to myself, okay, what do I want to say today? How do I take my feelings and put them through the guitar, right? And it's more than just, you know, like I heard someone say once, oh, if I'm happy, I'll play major, you know, like B.B. King style. And if I'm mad, I'll play minor. It's more than that, man. It's more like, how can you approach the guitar every day with the same kind of heart that you want to play, but it's like, you just have something new to say, you know, or a different way to say it.
Of course, no, it's the ultimate thing, the ultimate expression with the instrument when you have something to say with that. Now, this is one great instrument, obviously. We've got Old Glory over here as well. But could you let us into a little secret? Because I'm hearing that down the line, there's going to be a follow-up to Old Glory.
Absolutely. I'll say it right now, November. November is going to be my third Epiphone Les Paul Glory model. Which is a single P90 pickup in Pelham Blue.
Unbelievable. And what is this one going to be called?
This one's going to be called BLUESPOWER.
BLUESPOWER.
So check this out. You'll love this. This project started almost a year and a half ago. And I've always loved Pelham Blue. Whether it be old cars or like even, you know, like, what is it, the Dave Grohl or just like Pelham Blue.
Sure.
All that. It's like that surf thing. And I always wanted a Pelham Blue Les Paul. I just thought it looked so cool. And I have to say, they nailed it, because my Old Glory and my Gold Glory, right? They have almost like a matte finish on them, right? So like when you look at it, I'm just gonna pop this one real quick. We'll set this old gal down. When you look at it, yeah, it looks kind of shiny, but it's still got kind of almost like a, I don't wanna say a VOS or like a gloss finish,
yeah,
but
sure.
It's just, you know? But what's cool about these guitars, the more you play them, the more they kind of start to like age in.
Sure.
So I wanted a Pelham Blue, but I asked them, is it going to be hard to do? Because the last thing we want is like a really cheesy looking Pelham Blue, because that can look really cheap to me. They sent me it, man. I'm not even joking. I laughed out loud. I was like, home. It was so good.
They nailed it.
They nailed it. Other cool features, and I'm the first one to tell anyone, right to you, is the JJN, I'm going to have a signature Seymour Duncan.
Fantastic.
In the bridge. So it's going to be called the P90 silencer. So what it is, check this out, it is still a true single coil pickup, right? Just as you would find in a P90. But what they've done is they've been able to add in the same box two dummy coils on the outside that kick the hum back by, I would say, 85%.
Wow.
And I'm telling you, honestly, when I say this, if you hear it, and if you're like me and you're a P90 player, you go, yeah, it sounds like a P90. And then when you let off your volume, instead of going, you know, it's quiet. It's so nice, because I know a lot of players would love to maybe dip their toe in the P90 world, but they're like, I don't really want to deal with the buzz. And it can get pretty bad if you're jamming, and it's like, if you don't have a good one, those pickups are, they don't buzz barely, but like, you know, sometimes they're just like, oh, this is horrible. So this gives you the best of both worlds. You get a cool, different kind of tone, and it's like, you don't have that buzz.
Are these, is this signature guitar the only way to get the pickup?
At the moment, yes, but there will be in the future, I'll be releasing that on its own with Duncan, and we're actually also developing a neck version. Even though everyone knows me as like a bridge guy,
now with this, you know, with Dorothy, it's changed days, you know.
But the thing is, I think it's a really cool thing for players that want to stay traditional to the P90 sound, or they say, "Well, I like the guitar as it is." This will just let you get rid of that annoying buzz.
Yeah.
So it's cool.
Well, obviously we haven't got to see it today, but hopefully when you get back home, could you maybe send us something that we could put in?
Because I'm going to send an exclusive for you, man.
Love to show the guys just how it looks in your hands and getting to hear it and all that. Congratulations on that. Now, just before I let you go, because I know you got the show tonight, obviously fantastic songwriter, singer, incredible player. If you were just to go out on the road with, you know, a band just as a guitar player, right? Yeah. It could be any time, like past or present, you step in. What would be the gig that you would take?
Oh, that's a good one. I would say, oh, that's a lot I would want to do. I would want to do classic Allman Brothers. I'd want to do, man, I would be down to go with some jam bands even, you know, like a Government Mule. But also, like, if I'm shooting out with anyone, man, I want to go play with, you know, Hendrix Band of Gypsies. I'm such a fan of so much that's a really loaded question. I could sit here and keep raffling them off, you know what I mean? Yeah. But at present day, if there was a band I could go jam with right now, maybe like a Blackberry Smoke would be really cool, or the Rival Sons.
Killer, yeah, absolutely great. Awesome. And what's a guilty pleasure for you right now musically?
You know what it is? 80s stuff. You know, there's these bands in the early 80s that would use guitars almost more as effects, right? Not even guitar-y stuff. Like, I've been listening to these weird movie soundtracks. Like, go check out the Texas Chainsaw Massacre 2 soundtrack.
Okay.
There's some weird stuff on there, but it's good. That's a guilty pleasure. If anyone heard me listening to that, they'd be like, what are you listening to?
Yeah,
it's cool. You can find inspiration anywhere.
Absolutely, mate. Well, we'll get to see you again when you're in town.
Yeah.
At the end of the year, you've got a run of shows coming up all the way through the UK. And when are you going to be here again?
So I will be back. I'm not sure exact London date, but I will be in the UK from, what do you say, Peter? When will we be in the UK?
I believe you're going to be in the UK in October.
October. Most of October.
What we'll be doing, guys, is we'll put the links below to all the tour dates so you can check out and keep up to everything that Jared's getting up to, because, my God, the guy's doing a lot of stuff. And hopefully down the line we get to see a replica of Dorothy from Gibson,
man,
as well. You know?
Absolutely.
But, look, man, pleasure chatting to you today.
As always.
Have a great show tonight.
Thank you so much, man.
See you soon.
Cheers.